Ashet Audio presents Fred and Rose, the full story of Fred and Rose West and the Gloucester House of Horrors, written and read by Howard Sounes. Preface. In the last days of February 1994, articles began appearing in Gloucester's evening newspaper about human remains being uncovered under the garden of a house in the city. The address of the house was 25 Cromwell Street. The bones, for that is all the remains were after several years in the ground, had been tentatively identified by police as those of one of the daughters of the household, a girl named Heather West. She had not been seen alive since 1987, when she was aged 16. Her father, Fred West, a 52-year-old jobbing builder, and her mother, Rose, a 40-year-old prostitute, were arrested and questioned about the discovery. Rose was released after a few hours, but Fred was charged with Heather's murder. It was an interesting case, a man who had apparently killed his teenage daughter and hidden her under the patio, but it was by no means unique. Murders within families, generically known to the police as domestic killings, are relatively commonplace. For this reason, and the fundamental fact that Fred West had been charged, severely limiting what could properly be reported, the investigation at first received little coverage in the national media. The Daily Mirror, for example, printed just two short paragraphs on the morning of the 1st of March under the headline, Dad Faces Death Case. This situation changed slightly a few days later when it emerged that the police had discovered the remains of two more young women at Cromwell Street. The story was given more space and prominence in the press, even reaching the front pages under the headline, Garden of Evil, but was still overshadowed by other news. I was employed at the time as a staff reporter for the Sunday Mirror newspaper in London. Just after lunch on Saturday, the 5th of March, I took an unexpected telephone call from a source in Gloucestershire, a person whom I am bound by a confidence not to identify. I was told that over the last few hours there had been sensational developments in the Garden of Evil case, developments of which the press were unaware, partly because the police officers attached to the inquiry team had been sworn to secrecy. Fred West had committed an astonishing number of murders, far more than had previously been suspected. The remains of young women were buried not only in the garden of 25 Cromwell Street, as had been supposed, but also in the cellar of the house, under the bathroom floor, under the extension of a second property nearby, and in fields on the outskirts of the village where Fred West was born. The police calculated there were at least nine more victims to be found, making, with the remains of the three already discovered, a possible total of 12. An experimental radar device used over the previous 24 hours had indicated at least five graves in the cellar alone. While I listened to this incredible information on the telephone, trying to note every detail of what had happened, police officers were using pneumatic drills to break up the concrete floor. I was told that the dead were probably all young women. The likely victims included lodgers, hitchhikers, and girls snatched from bus stops. Fred West was talking freely about these girls, and from the casual way in which he discussed their fates, detectives believed he had almost certainly killed many more. Even in those first few moments, it was clear this was to number among the most extraordinary murder cases in British criminal history. I worked on the story with the Sunday Mirror's crime reporter, the late Chris House, who was able to corroborate what I had been told. Pondering the introduction to our article, which would appear on the front page, we cast about for a new name for the investigation, a phrase more appropriate than Garden of Evil. We came up with House of Horrors. In retrospect, it may not have been the most original idea, but it is the name that has stuck and has been widely used since. It first appeared in connection with the Wests on page one of the Sunday Mirror that weekend. Following on from the headline was a lengthy article breaking the story of the macabre contents of 25 Cromwell Street and the existence of the other graves, thereby revealing the true scale of the case. The remains of several more young women were indeed recovered from inside 25 Cromwell Street over the following days, and enormous media interest came to focus on that plain, semi-detached house. Journalists arrived in Gloucester from all over the country and the world, eager to discover everything about the West family. There had not been such a newsworthy British murder story since 1983, when civil servant Dennis Nielsen was found to have killed 15 young men. In many ways, the West case was more comparable to that of Myra Hindley and Ian Brady, who had murdered a number of children in the 1960s. The following weekend, I wrote a second article, this time reporting that the human remains found at the house had been cut into pieces and that there was evidence of sexual torture. A week later, I identified the exact location in the fields near Fred West's childhood home, where the police were soon to dig for more victims. The front page of the 27th of March issue of the Sunday Mirror reported that the remains already recovered were not complete. Many bones were missing, especially from the feet and hands. This would later prove to be a most unsettling mystery. It became apparent that such mayhem could not be the work of Fred West alone, although he was the only person to be charged at this point. It seemed likely that Rose had been as much involved in the murders as her husband, and that it was her appetite for sadistic lesbian sex which had been the motivation for most of the killings. On the 10th of April 1994, I reported that arrests would be made regarding sex abuse at Cromwell Street, and on the 21st of April, Rose West was brought before magistrates charged with raping a young girl. It was this that first put her behind bars. On the 24th of April, I reported that she was being closely questioned about the murders of her daughter Heather and another young girl. The next day, Rose was charged with murder for the first time. On the 1st of May, I wrote that she would now be charged with murdering all nine women found at Cromwell Street, and as the weeks went by, this also happened. A great number of newspaper articles have subsequently been devoted to this story, but they do not sufficiently explain the murders or the nature of the people involved to attempt to understand why so many young women died in and around 25 Cromwell Street. It is necessary to learn about the personalities of and relationship between Fred and Rose West. Newspapers, and indeed policemen, are never very interested in this. It is enough for them to describe the murderers as evil and psychopathic, leaving us none the wiser as to what motivated such violence. But there is relevant information to discover. In the chapters that follow, I have tried to set out the story of the lives of this extraordinary couple as factually and dispassionately as possible. My purpose is not to excuse the crimes, but to help explain how Fred and Rose developed into people capable of such behaviour. The reader will notice that there is little personal comment in the main part of the book. I do hold strong opinions regarding all aspects of the story, but have reserved these views for the epilogue. Numerous people helped me in my work on Fred and Rose, which took more than 18 months to research and write. I am grateful to them all, but want to thank the following individuals and organisations in particular. Fred West's brother and sister-in-law, Doug and Christine West, Rose West's mother, Mrs. Daisy Letts, and the editors and staff at Mirror Group, especially the late Chris House, Alan Sampson and Andrew Gordon at Little Brown Warner, Karen Tass, and Gloucester Police, including most notably Detective Superintendent John Bennett, who has been as helpful as the restrictions of his difficult job permitted. Prologue. The gulls from Gloucester docks perch on top of 25 Cromwell Street, crying and flapping their wings noisily as Fred West comes home. The birds have nested in the space between the roof and the gutter of his house and are a constant nuisance. Fred glares up at them as he opens and then closes behind him the black and gold front gate. He pauses to cast an eye over his property. Fred is extremely proud of this modest, semi-detached house and has made a great many improvements since he and his wife Rose moved here 20 years ago. An unusually ornate house sign, fashioned in wrought iron, represents the care he has lavished on the building. 25 Cromwell Street is picked out in curly white letters, set in a black frame. The address is also painted on the black plastic rubbish bins in the tiny front yard. Some years ago, Fred rendered the outside walls with sand-coloured concrete, and this is still in fair condition, although there are dark streaks at the top where rainwater runs down through faults in the Victorian guttering. The three sash windows spaced one above the other at the front are hung with net curtains. Their frames are pea green. Facing Fred is a second pair of iron gates, about 6 feet tall, painted grey and fastened with a lock in the middle. The key is under a stone. As Fred reaches down to pick up the key, he sees one of the young student girls from the bedsitters making her way to the local shop, the Wellington Stores. There is a college at the back of Fred's house, and many of the students rent accommodation in Cromwell Street because it is cheap and convenient. Fred earns extra money by carrying out odd jobs for the landlords of these bedsitters, and recently mended a handle on the window of this particular girl's room, so he calls out a cheery hello. His rural Herefordshire accent seems out of place here in the inner city. The student likes Fred and his wife, as most of the neighbours do. When she was unwell recently and staying home from college, Mrs. West offered to visit the chemist for her, saying, "I'm only a couple of doors away if you need me." So the girl stops to speak with Fred and asks after the health of the couple's large brood of children. Fred says he hopes she has a boyfriend to take her out tonight. If not, she is very welcome to come over to 25 and have a drink with him and Rose. They could watch a video together. There is a lewd tone to the way he speaks, and the student can see why some of her friends warned her not to be in when he called to mend the window lock. He had made an odd comment then about having slept with hundreds of women and fathering over 40 children. It seemed such an absurd boast that she laughed out loud. He is not even a handsome man. He has a wide face and distinctive simian features, a protruding jaw and small crooked nose. His hair is such a dark brown that it appears black and grows in an unruly clump. Long, old-fashioned sideburns spread down the sides of his jaw. His teeth are badly decayed, and one of the two front incisors is chipped, accentuating a gap. Fred is of medium height and limps when he walks. He is slightly overweight around the middle, but despite this appears fit and strong. The student assumes Fred is in his late 40s, maybe older. He invariably wears the same navy blue donkey jacket that he has on today, a dark patterned sweater and blue jeans. His hands are grimy and he has not shaved, but it is his brilliant blue eyes that are most striking. They say goodbye. Fred unlocks the double gates and carefully locks them behind him again. He opens the front door, which has been stained dark brown, in an attempt to make it look like oak. There is a square glass panel at eye level and a small electric coaching lamp on the wall. A lucky horseshoe is nailed above the door, reminding Fred of the country village where he grew up. Inside number 25 there is an odd, fusty smell. The small hallway is painted lime green. On the left is a locked door, and there is another door directly ahead. Fred calls out, "Rose, Rose," in his gruff way. There is no answer, so he walks through the second door, which leads into his tool room. Apart from Fred's building equipment, there is also a washing machine and spin dryer in here. He passes through another door and down a step into an open living area featuring an arch breakfast bar with a formica surface and stools set before it. There is also a sofa upholstered in green velour, a television, and a cream dialed telephone on a shelf. The walls are covered with artificial pine boarding, speckled with dozens of knots, and there is a wooden pillar in the middle of the room supporting the roof. This extension and all the fittings inside are the result of Fred's passion for DIY. Several children sit around. Some are white-skinned, others black. They range in age from toddlers to teenagers. They have been chattering amongst themselves but fall silent as Dad walks into the room, dropping his heavy bag of tools on the floor. "Where's your mum?" asks Fred. One of the teenagers quietly replies that their mother is upstairs, adding that she is with one of her friends. Fred takes off his jacket and walks back through the tool room, unlocking the door on the right in the hallway. He locks it behind him again and walks up a flight of approximately 7 steps. At the top, Fred turns and climbs a further short flight, taking him up to a landing which leads into another lounge. There is a large walk-in bar by the window, stocked with a variety of drinks. A mural of a tropical island covers one wall. On the carpet by the sofa are 2 glasses, still with a little alcohol in the bottom, and an ashtray. A cloud of cigarette smoke lingers. Fred notices a video has been left on. The picture is of poor quality, the colours are too bright, and there is little definition. But it is clear what type of film it is. A young woman is wearing a bizarre costume made of pieces of shiny black material and straps. Only her eyes and mouth can be seen through holes in the mask she is wearing. A man is touching her from behind, and she appears to be in pain. Fred turns the volume down, but the sound of a woman moaning still emanates from somewhere in the room. It is amplified in a tinny way, as if from the speaker of a cheap radio. Fred settles himself on the sofa, moving a cushion embroidered with the word "mum," and reaches down to an intercom which is plugged into the skirting board. The intercom has a speaker attachment, and he holds this to his ear. Fred can now hear 2 people having sex in another part of the house. Most of the noise is made by a woman. She is breathing hard and shouting as if she is being hurt. Fred can hear flesh being slapped. He listens to his wife having sex as the afternoon light fades and everything except the glowing television picture diminishes into gloom. Sometimes Rose makes so much noise that she can be clearly heard even without the intercom. The sound comes from the room directly above the bar. When it eventually stops, Fred puts down the intercom. Momentarily at a loss as to what to do, he decides to move his van round to the front of the house. Outside, the orange streetlights have come on. It is a dowdy, unattractive area, and most of the properties are neglected, with rubbish piled up by the doors. Police sirens wail through the city, and a loud argument can be heard from the upstairs window of one of the bedsitters. Because Cromwell Street is so central, shoppers and office workers park their cars here. Fred often finds that he has to leave his van round the corner in Cromwell Terrace and then move it again after 6 o'clock, so it is safely in front of his property before he goes to bed. When he has moved his van, Fred sits in the cab for a moment, watching as the door of his house opens and a small West Indian man comes out. The man looks left and right, quickly, furtively. Behind him in the doorway, a plump woman with dark hair clutches together a dressing gown of faded pink toweling. The man hurries away in the direction of Eastgate Street, and the woman closes the door. The fluorescent light is on in the breakfast bar area, making the pine walls appear a queasy yellow colour. Rose is in the kitchen preparing Fred's supper. She is in her late 30s, of medium height and quite fat. Her hair is glossy, almost black, and cut short, but it falls down at the front over her eyes. Rose wears large spectacles with coloured plastic frames and gold-coloured hoop earrings. Her skin is olive with a fuzz of fine black hair growing on her upper lip. Apart from the dressing gown, she wears slippers and long white nylon socks. When she turns to get the salt from the unit behind her, she sees that one of the children is sitting on the work surface. "Fucking get off," she yells, striking out with her hand. "You made a right old row, Rosie," says Fred, not as a rebuke, but as if he's complimenting her. Rose is at the sink now, opening a bag of frozen peas with scissors. "He enjoyed it, evidently," she agrees, nodding to some £5 notes by her purse. "Says he is coming again next week." Fred rolls himself a cigarette contentedly. Dinner is a simple affair, defrosted food with slices of white bread and a glass of tap water. Fred eats quickly, talking to Rose as he does so about all he has done in the day. He has been at Stroud Court, a home for autistic people near the village of Nailsworth. His employers are paid to carry out maintenance work for the institution. Fred says that when he was driving back to the depot near Stroud, he saw a woman by the side of the road holding her skirt up for him. He could see everything. Neither Rose nor the children react to this, considering Fred to be off in a world of his own. He then asks the family if they can guess who he saw as he was driving along Barton Street this evening. Without a pause, he answers his own question, "I seen Heather." The mention of this name transforms the atmosphere in the room. Suddenly, everybody is listening to Fred. Heather is Fred's and Rose's first-born daughter. None of the children have seen her since she apparently left home several years earlier. It is difficult for the younger ones even to remember what their sister looked like because all of her photographs have disappeared from the house. "I come down Barton Street and there she was. She is a working girl now, mind. She is what's-her-name, selling drugs and that. I called out, 'Hi, Heather,' but I couldn't stop," said Fred. The children ask, "How did she look, Dad?" Making no comment about Fred's claim that their sister is a prostitute and a drug dealer. He used to say she was a lesbian because she never had a boyfriend. The children think Fred is sex mad. "She looked rough, but she must be making a good bit of money, mind," Fred replies. Rose's face becomes flushed and she glares at Fred angrily. She jumps up from the sofa, snatches his plate and pushes past him into the kitchen, scraping the leftovers into the red pedal bin by the door. Fred falls silent. He knows how fierce Rose's temper can be and that she does not like him talking about Heather. He sits and watches the back of Rose's head. She is standing at the glass doors that lead out into the back garden. Rain is falling, making the coloured patio slabs shiny. It was wet like this when Heather died. Fred's gaze drifts across to the edge of the patio by the fir trees, and then his blue eyes glaze over thoughtfully. The telephone rings abruptly. It is for Fred. He is called out by one of the local landlords to visit a bedsitter down the street. A bath has overflowed, and the ceiling of the room below is ruined. The landlord wants Fred to patch up the damage and then arrange a time to repair the plaster. He will be paid in cash, and Fred is never known to turn down extra work, even on a Friday night, so he goes out. When he returns home, most of the lights are off and the house is quiet. He turns on the television just in time to watch a late news bulletin. Fred has no patience with most programs, but always tries to catch the headlines. Rose is in bed in their room on the top floor of the house. Fred undresses and climbs in beside her, turning off the light. He regrets having mentioned Heather's name today, upsetting Rose, but he thinks they should try and maintain the fiction that their daughter is still alive. Thinking of Heather reminds him of all the other girls who have died. Fred puts his arms around Rose and closes his eyes. Faces flicker in his mind like ghosts, and then there is blackness. Chapter 1. The Blue-Eyed Boy. The village of Much Markle lies just off the A449, halfway between the market towns of Ledbury and Ross-on-Wye, in rich Herefordshire countryside, 120 miles west of London. The Malvern Hills are to the north, the Wye Valley is to the west, and the Forest of Dean to the south. Gloucester, the nearest major city, is 14 miles away across the River Severn. At the beginning of the Second World War, Much Markle was a village of approximately 700 people, most of whom were employed on the land. An ancient settlement dating back to the Iron Age, the unusual name of the village derives from Old English meaning boundary wood. The prefix Much sets it apart from the neighbouring hamlet of Little Markle. The local accent is distinctive. Gloucester is pronounced Glaster, and sentences are often concluded with the word mind, pronounced mind. There are several grand residences in the village, including a Queen Anne rectory and home house, the setting for a wedding scene in the Victorian book Kilvert's Diary. Much Markle's other notable buildings are the half-timbered cottages, the red brick schoolhouse, the memorial hall, and cider factory. Standing on opposite sides of the main road are Weston's Garage and the Warwin Arms Public House. And along the lane from the Warwin Arms is the 13th century sandstone parish church, St. Bartholomew's, distinguished by its higgledy-piggledy graveyard and imposing gargoyled tower. The surrounding countryside is a pleasing sweep of green pasture and golden corn, with orchards of heavy cider apples and venerable peri pear trees left over from the last century, geometric hop fields and ploughed acres of plain red soil. In fact, it is such an uneventful place that a landslide during the reign of Elizabeth I long remained the most fantastical event in Much Markle's history. For 3 days in 1575, there was much fear and excitement in the parish when Markley Hill roused itself out of a dead sleep and with a roaring noise removed from the place where it stood, destroying all in its path, including hedgerows, two highways, and a chapel. A wall of earth and stone 15 feet high was the result of this mysterious upheaval, and it is marked to this day on Ordnance Survey maps as the Wonder. The Markle and Yatton Flower Show and Sports Fair has been held in a field on the edge of the village on the last Saturday in August since the 1890s. It is the main summer event in the area, a descendant of the more ancient Markle fairs. Stallholders sell food, fancy goods and clothing. There are also fairground rides, exhibitions and sports, including a 5.5 mile road race between Ledbury and the village. It was during the August of 1939 when the man who would become Fred West's father sauntered down the lane from the nearby hamlet of Preston, heading for the Markle Fair. Walter West, a powerfully built young farmhand, was born in 1914 and had been raised near the town of Ross-on-Wye. He was intimidated as a child by his army sergeant father, a forbidding character who was decorated for his service in the Great War of 1914-18. Walter complained that even when the old man came out of the army, he did not leave its disciplinarian ways behind. With little education, barely able to read or write, Walter had left school at the age of 11 to work on the land. His maternal grandfather was a wagoner, employed to tend farm horses and their tackle. Walter became the wagoner's boy. He had married for the first time when he was 23 to a nurse, almost exactly twice his age. One of twin sisters, Gertrude Maddox, was a 45-year-old spinster with a long, kindly face. She married Walter in 1937, and they set up home together in Preston. Walter went to work at Thomas's farm nearby. Gertrude was unable to have children, so the couple decided to foster a one-year-old boy named Bruce from an orphanage. 2 years into the marriage, Gertrude met a bizarre death when, on a hot June day, she was stung by a bee, collapsed, and died as young Bruce stood helplessly by. Walter found her body sprawled on the garden path when he returned home. After the funeral, he realized that he was unable to care for his adopted son on his own and handed the boy back to the orphanage. Walter always spoke fondly of his first wife, despite the considerable age gap between them and the brevity of their marriage. He kept her photograph and the brass-bound Maddox family Bible among his most valued possessions for the rest of his life. It was 2.5 months after Gertrude's funeral when Walter attended the 1939 Markle Fair. He was loafing along between the attractions when he came to a needlework stall where a wavy-haired girl was displaying her work. The girl was shy and unforthcoming, but Walter eventually discovered that her name was Daisy Hill and that she was in service in Lebury. Her parents lived in a tied cottage named Cow Lees on a sloping track known as Cow Lane near Western Cider Factory in the village. Her father, William Hill, was a familiar figure in the area, a tall, skinny man with a large black moustache who tended a milking herd of Hereford cattle. His family had been in Much Markle, mostly working the land, for as long as anyone could remember, and were sometimes mocked in the village as being simple-minded. Because they were named Hill, and their home was built on a slight rise, the family were known as the Hillbillies. One of four children, Daisy Hannah Hill, was only 16 years old when she met Walter. She was an unworldly young girl, short and squat of figure, with a plain face and a gap between her two front teeth. Daisy was flattered and surprised by the attentions of this mature man and accepted Walter's invitation to take a turn with him on the swing boats. They whooped excitedly as they rode through the air above the green countryside, marvelling at how far they could see. They courted for a while as Walter continued to live at Preston, a half-hour walk from the home of Daisy's parents. He then took a job as a cowman, like Daisy's father. Walter married Daisy at St. Bartholomew's on the 27th of January 1940. Before the service, friends and family gathered under the ancient yew tree outside the church porch, making sure their ties were straight and their shoes clean. Where Walter's first wife had been so much older than him, there was much comment among the guests that the second Mrs. Walter West was a girl of only 17. Daisy wore a white dress with a veil, gloves, and little silver slippers. She carried tulips and a lucky horseshoe. The groom was a burly man who looked older than his 26 years. He was dressed in his good dark suit, draping his pocket watch and chain across his waistcoat, and wore a carnation in his buttonhole. When it came to signing the parish register, Walter betrayed his lack of education by printing his name in large, childish letters. He had found living in Preston upsetting after Gertrude's death, so the newly married couple set up home at Veld House Cottages, just off the A449 main road. Daisy fell pregnant with their first child almost immediately. She was 8 months into her term and alone in the house when there was a knock at the door one evening. Daisy did not like opening up when Walter was out milking, but the visitor would not go away, so she had little choice. Confronting her was a stern-looking policeman in full uniform. Daisy was such a nervous and unsophisticated young girl that she found the sight of the policeman deeply upsetting, even though there was nothing for her to worry about. He explained that there had been a road accident outside the cottage. A man had been knocked off his bicycle, and the policeman wanted to know whether she had witnessed anything. Daisy gabbled that she had not, and quickly said goodbye, but the visit had so excited her that, by the time Walter returned home, his wife had gone into labour. A tiny baby daughter was born prematurely, later that night, and given the name Violet. She died in the cradle a few days later. Walter and Daisy then moved into a red-brick tied cottage at a lonely but pretty junction in the village known as Cecil's Corner. The surrounding fields were covered with wild flowers, and a footpath known as the Daffodil Way cut across a nearby meadow. Bickerton Cottage was almost 100 years old and very primitive. It had neither electricity nor gas, and its water was drawn from a well in the garden by hand pump. To the left of the front door was a living room with an antiquated iron cooking range. Both this room and the scullery had stone floors and low ceilings. A small flight of narrow stairs led up to two box-like bedrooms. The windows of the little house were four tiny squares that looked out over an orchard of apple trees, and on the other side of the lane, a large willow. The Wests kept chickens and a pig in an outhouse behind the cottage. This was also where they emptied the bucket that was their only toilet. Once settled in, Daisy became pregnant again. She took to her bed in late 1941 to give birth for the second time, groaning with pain throughout a bleak autumn night. A fire was built in her bedroom and water was set to boil on the range downstairs. Daisy could hear the barking of foxes and the hoot of owls as the clock ticked away the hours of darkness. At last, as the sky lightened with the dawn, a healthy baby boy was born, gulping his first breath at 8:30 a.m. on the 29th of September, 1941. 4 weeks later, the proud parents carried their son down the lane, through the gate of St. Bartholomew's, and into the chill of the nave. The Reverend Alexander Spittle bent to his work over the Norman tub font. He murmured the baptism as the water trickled through his hands, naming the screaming infant Frederick Walter Stephen West. It would soon be abbreviated to Freddie West, and later on to Fred West. The joy and pride that Daisy felt was obvious for all to see. She took little Freddie to her bed each night, where she cuddled and petted the boy, often to the exclusion of her husband. Hers was a beautiful baby. The curly hair that would later grow so dark was straw yellow at first, and everybody marvelled at his astonishing blue eyes, shining like two huge sapphires. Daisy displayed Freddie's christening card in a prominent position in the cottage, illuminated in gold, red and blue, like a page from a sacred book. The card read, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved." Daisy gave birth to six more children over the following decade in conditions of considerable poverty. For several years, it seemed as if she had hardly given birth to one child before falling pregnant with the next. The Second World War brought the additional hardship of rationing to the village. Walter earned only £6 per week, and the family quite literally had to live off the land. Windfall cooking apples and other fruit could be collected free from the orchard behind the cottage. Chickens were kept for eggs and to provide a bird at Christmas. Walter brought pails of unpasteurized milk home from the farm each day, and in the evening and at weekends tended his vegetable garden. Daisy baked her own bread and worked at her laundry in an iron tub behind the cottage. As she washed, Daisy cooed and fussed over Freddy, who stared back at her from his cradle with his big blue eyes. The next baby, John Charles Edward, arrived in November 1942, just 13 months after Fred. The relationship between the two boys would be the closest and most complex of any of the children. Walter and Daisy seldom left their sons alone and seemed to care for them very much. John Cox, who has lived next door to Bickerton Cottage since 1927, remembers, "They thought a lot of the children. If ever they went off, they took the kiddies with them on their bicycles." Daisy gave birth to her third son within 11 months of having John. David Henry George was born on the 24th of October 1943, when Fred was two, but suffered from a heart defect and died a month later. It was partly because of his death that Daisy wanted to move on from Bickerton Cottage. They went to live at a house named Hill's Barn in the village. Daisy again fell pregnant. Her first daughter, Daisy Elizabeth Mary, was born in September 1944 and came to look most like her mother. They would be known in the family as Little Daisy and Big Daisy. In July 1946, the family moved for the last time to the house where Fred grew up. Moor Court Cottage was tied to Moor Court Farm, owned by Frank Brooks, where Walter found work tending to the milking herd and helping with the harvest. Despite being called a cottage, it is actually quite a large building, semi-detached with two chimney stacks and a dormer window set in the tiled roof. It stands on the outskirts of Muchmarkle, at a bend in the Dimmock Road, surrounded by open country. Looking out of the front windows, there are uninterrupted views of the field stretching away to May Hill in the distance, cows low in the meadows, and the spire of St. Bartholomew's within an embrace of yew trees is just visible over to the right of the panorama. In the autumn after they moved into Moor Court Cottage, Daisy gave birth to her final son, Douglas. At first, he shared his mother's bed, as the other babies had, but was then put in with Fred and John. Kathleen, known as Kitty and the prettiest of the girls, was born 14 months later. Gwen's birth in 1951 completed the family. Daisy, having borne eight children in 10 years, was now a heavy-set 28-year-old woman, hardened by life and quite different in looks and character to the timid teenager Walter had married. Conditions at Moor Court Cottage were basic. Eight slept in three cramped bedrooms, one for Mr. and Mrs. West, one for the three girls, and one for the boys, where Doug took the single bed and Fred and John shared the double. A tin bath was set in front of the parlour fire on wash nights, the children bathing under the watch of a pair of crude, ornamental Alsatian dogs, which Walter had won at the Hereford Fair. Toilet facilities consisted of a simple bucket, which had to be emptied each morning into a sewage pit, and rats were a constant pest. When Daisy saw one crossing the yard, she would blast at it with Walter's shotgun. One of Fred's abiding memories of his mother was of her shooting at varmints. Of the six surviving children, Fred was his mother's favourite. Coming after the tragedy of Violet's death, he was particularly precious. The son that Walter had wanted and the answer to Daisy's prayers. As the baby grew up, he could do no wrong. Younger brother Doug describes Fred as Mammy's blue-eyed boy. Daisy believed whatever Fred told her and took his side in squabbles between the children. For his part, Fred adored his mother and did exactly as she said. The bond between them was perhaps unnaturally close. Fred came first with Daisy, even in front of water. She thought the world of Fred, says her sister-in-law, Edna Hill. Partly as a result of this mollycoddling, Fred was a spoilt, dull, and introverted child. He was also scruffy. Daisy did her best to dress him nicely in baggy shorts held up with braces, cotton shirts, and sleeveless Fair Isle sweaters, but Fred always managed to look unkempt. Thick, curly brown hair grew up in a little bush on top of his head, just like his mother, whose looks he had inherited. Doug and John looked more like their father, and also got along with him, which Fred never did. There had been an awkwardness between father and son from the day Daisy brought Freddie into her bed. Walter was well liked in the village. He was a regular at the Warwyn Arms on Saturday nights and was sociable enough to organise the once or twice yearly village outings to the seaside, usually to Barry Island in South Wales. The day trips were the only holiday most of the villagers ever had, and they would pose for group photographs upon arrival to mark the occasion. Fred tends to look happy when he is photographed with his family, as long as his father is not in the frame. One snapshot shows Fred laughing uproariously with brother Doug as his mother clowns about with a neighbour, but when Walter's stern face was in the picture, as it is in the surviving photograph of the Barry Island trips, Fred looks distinctly uncomfortable. At the age of 5, Fred was enrolled in the village school, the only one he ever attended, serving for both his junior and senior education. The backwaters of Herefordshire were slow in improving education standards after the war, and there was no secondary school in the area until 1961. The West brothers walked the 2 miles there and back every day, joining up with groups of other local children along the way. Discipline was strict. Classmates remember Fred as being dim, dirty, and always in trouble because of his slovenly performance. He was regularly given the slipper. After the age of 8, he was old enough to be caned along with the rest of the children. Daisy was outraged by these regular punishments, which Fred tearfully reported back to her. His class squealed in delight at the sight of Mrs. West, dressed in one of her big floral frocks, with her hands on her hips, haranguing their teacher after Fred had been hit. Fred became known as a mummy's boy, partly because of these scenes, and was repeatedly mocked and bullied. After school and at weekends, the children were expected to work. If Fred or his brothers and sisters wanted to buy an ice cream or a chocolate bar, they had to earn the money to pay for it. There were also regular household chores, like chopping wood for the fire, that they had to carry out for no reward. The jobs they worked at outside the house followed the seasons of the year. Spring found Fred leading his younger brothers and sisters on an expedition up the Dimmock Road to Letterbox Field, where they would gather bunches of wild daffodils to sell at the roadside. The countryside around Muchmarkle is famous for daffodils and a blaze of colour in the spring. Years later, Fred stole back across the same fields to bury the corpse of his first wife. In the long dog days of summer, the local women and children rose early to meet the hop truck. This rumbled out of the village along dusty lanes to the pungent hop fields where they worked until the light faded. They also picked strawberries and other soft fruit. The children with their own little baskets toiled alongside the adults, their fingers becoming sticky as they worked. Harvest promised the exciting summer sport of rabbiting, which in turn would lead to delicious pies and roasts for the undernourished families. Beaters walked through the wheat just before the harvesting machines began to work. Then boys, armed with sticks, followed along the edges of the field and clubbed any rabbits that sprang out. The cull was a necessary part of feeding the poor of the village, and the rabbits were shared out at the end of the day, with an extra one or two going to large, needy families like the Wests. "They were for eating, oh aye," says Doug West, licking his lips. "We would take them home, skin them and eat them. My mum was a good cook, rabbit stew, roast rabbit, anything." Autumn evenings were spent at home listening to the Dan Dare adventure series on the radio and playing darts. The Wests owned a wind-up gramophone, complete with a collection of scratchy 78s. At one stage, Fred took up Spanish guitar, but he had little patience with the instrument, which soon became an ornament hung on the wall of the front room. During the severe West Country winters, the children pulled on their moth-eaten cardigans and went sledging on Markle Hill. Fred was a quiet boy with few friends of his own, relying on his family, particularly John, for companionship. Although John was a year younger, he was physically stronger than Fred and, probably out of jealousy of his favoured brother, bullied him. The third boy, Doug, who was small enough to be left out of their fights, remembers that John used to beat the hell out of Fred. Walter milked the herd morning and evening. On Sunday, Daisy would sometimes keep him company, leaving the children on their own, and this is when the trouble often started. Fred developed the habit of going outside the cottage and pulling faces at John through the window, until his younger brother became so enraged that he punched at Fred. The windows were made of small panes, and John's little fists were enough to knock the glass out. Naturally, Walter was furious when he returned, warning them not to do it again and threatening a beating if they disobeyed him. Sometimes he would be provoked into taking the thick leather belt from his work trousers to hit the boys. The Wests were cut off from the world in their lonely cottage, and it is possible they became closer than is natural. There have always been rumours in the village that Daisy West harboured something more than motherly love for Fred. It is said she took her eldest son back into her bed when he was aged about 12, and that she seduced him. This would not have been such an unusual act for a community like Much Markle. Deviant sex was not uncommon in the Herefordshire countryside. In Cider with Rosie, for example, his account of an idyllic childhood between the wars, Laurie Lee wrote about a community very similar to Much Markle, pointing out that sexual transgressions flourished where the roads were bad. Even if it is true that Daisy seduced Fred, and her family cannot confirm the story, it was probably Walter who was the dominant influence upon Fred's emerging sexuality. In later life, Fred often spoke about his father's sexual appetites, claiming Walter indulged in one of the greatest taboos of all, having sex with children. Fred claimed that Walter abused young girls and spoke openly about it, saying what he did was natural and that he had a right to do so. Fred grew up with exactly the same mentality, never thinking that having intercourse with a child might be wrong. He maintained that everybody did it. Away from home, Fred's first sexual experiences took place in the golden fields around Moorcourt Cottage. Shortly after he entered puberty, Fred was taking part in fumbling sex games there. "We used to dive in the hay, take pot luck and go for it," he later bragged, saying that he cared little about the age or identity of the girls involved. Fred's formal education was soon over. He had learned little at school and left at the age of 15 without taking any exams, being barely numerate and unable to read or write beyond the level of a 7-year-old. He had displayed some talents, though. Fred was artistic and drew with instinctive accuracy. In his final years at school, he had taken woodwork classes and showed an aptitude for practical work, constructing a 3-legged milking stool and a bench. Both of these were presented to his mother. he went to work with water on Moorcourt Farm and the neighbouring Bridges Farm. The land was a mixture of arable and livestock. Corn and potatoes were grown, and cows and sheep reared. As the youngest labourer, Fred had to muck in, doing whatever jobs the older farmhands passed on to him. It was an unkempt, dull-looking youth who stood in mud up to his Wellington boot tops each day. His brown hair was uncombed and his old check shirt torn. Tufts of adolescent beard stuck out from his chin and his teeth were yellow because he rarely bothered to clean them. When asked a question, Fred would look away and either mumble or gabble his answer, making it hard to understand what he said or thought. But there was one sight guaranteed to make him pay attention, and that was if a girl walked down the lane. Then Fred's startling blue eyes would open wide, and his young, monkey-like face would break into a gap-toothed, lascivious grin. Chapter 2. Brain Damage. In 1957, John West left Markle's school and went to work on the farm with Fred and their father. Life as an unskilled labourer was poorly paid, but the West boys could expect nothing better. Their father had been a farm worker all his life, as had their maternal grandfather, William Hill, and his father before him. There was no reason to hope or think that John and Fred would ever do anything else. An acquaintance of Fred's at the time, Patrick Meredith, says that he fully expected Fred to be walking behind a cow with a stick for the rest of his life. It was hard, unforgiving work, and not without its physical hazards, as Fred found out when Walter suffered a serious accident shortly after the boys had started on the farm. The old man was lying under a tractor, attempting to mend a part, when the handbrake failed, allowing the machine to roll forward and trap his chest. He was freed, but was left with just one functioning lung. Walter's eldest sons began to go into the nearby market town of Ledbury at weekends. The town represented much Markle's nearest bright lights, 5.5 miles to the north at the foot of the Malvern Hills. Its high street featured a cinema, chip shop, milk bar and youth club. In the middle of the town, opposite the clock tower, stood the Tudor Market House. Raised up on 16 oak pillars, this offered a sheltered place for teenagers to meet. Some of the youths who gathered under the market house lived in Ledbury, while others, like John and Fred, came in from the surrounding villages, travelling by motorcycle or pushbike. Their average wages were little more than £3 a week, so entertainment was necessarily simple. Evenings were spent chatting and smoking under the market house or lounging in the cheaper seats at the Ledbury Picture House, where Fred enjoyed watching John Wayne films. They did not go to pubs, but drank coffee in the chip shop, which doubled as a cafe. One of the few places for teenagers to go in the evenings was the Ledbury Youth Club, run by Ken Stainer, a veteran of the King's African Rifles, who persevered with the club despite considerable opposition. The view expressed in letters to the local newspaper was that the club was part of the then fashionable problem of delinquent youth and should be shut down. Its loud rock and roll music, smashed windows and noise of motorcycles were apparently constant problems. But in retrospect, the entertainment was remarkably innocent. With nothing more intoxicating than coffee and Coca-Cola to drink, the teenagers played table tennis and billiards, watched television, and listened to records by Adam Faith and Elvis Presley. A few of the girls attempted the jive while the boys, including Fred, slouched in the background dragging on cigarettes. Now that he was age 16, Fred was taking more of an interest in his appearance. He had started to shave properly, combed his hair before going out, and wore clean clothes. The girls who attended the youth club considered him to be one of the best-looking boys around town, and Fred's future sister-in-law, Christine West, remembers that he was the talk of her school. Fred was always chatting up girls, she says. But his manner was crude. For every impressionable teenager who had a crush on Fred, there were many more who considered him boorish and unpleasant. These teenagers ridiculed Fred as a country bumpkin and called him a dirty gypsy, although, contrary to widespread belief, there is no gypsy blood in his immediate family. If Fred saw a girl he liked at the club or at a dance, he simply grabbed at her. It did not matter to Fred whether she was interested in him or not. He also took a perverse delight in trying to steal girls away from other boys. In the same way that he had goaded John by pulling faces at him through the parlour windows, Fred went up to other boys' dates just for the hell of it, says his brother Doug. When it came to a fight, John would have to step in to defend his brother because Fred would never hit back. John's willingness to stick up for Fred, no matter how badly he behaved, was part of a fierce code of loyalty that the West family shared. An attack on one would always bring the wrath of the others. We could row amongst ourselves till the cows come home, but nobody else was allowed to pick on the family, explains Doug. Fred often visited H.C. Cecil's motorcycle shop off the high street in Lebury. He found motorcycles exciting and knew that if he had his own transport, he would also have some freedom from Moorcourt Cottage. A small machine was within his reach if he saved. The motorcycle that took Fred's fancy was a 125cc James with a mauve-coloured tank. His mother was against the idea, but relented on the condition that Fred promised to sell it if he had a crash. He agreed and took delivery of a brand new James around the time of his 17th birthday. A photograph shows Fred proudly straddling his new machine while his brothers and sisters gather round grinning. Little Gwen perched on the tank between her brother's arms and sister Daisy resting against his shoulders. Brian Hill was a country boy who, like Fred, came into Lebury at weekends and loitered around the market house. Brian became one of Fred's few friends and was allowed to ride the motorcycle. At the chip shop, which was among their regular haunts, Brian remembers that Fred would ostentatiously park the James outside before sauntering in. He tried to be the big one for show. When they were not riding the motorcycle, they often parked it in the alley next to the Plough public house, stripping it down to clean the engine. On the evening of the 28th of November 1958, Fred was riding his James 125 home along the Dimmock Road when he had an accident. He was just a few hundred yards from Moorcourt Cottage when he collided with a local girl named Pat Manns, who had been cycling in the opposite direction back to the neighbouring hamlet of Preston Cross, where she lived with her parents. There are a number of possible explanations for the accident. There may have been a car involved, the country road was not lit, and the lights on both the pushbike and motorcycle were dim by modern standards. At the point where they collided, there were also several potholes. It has even been suggested in village gossip that Fred deliberately rode into the girl. Whatever the cause, they were both sent sprawling across the road. A labourer from Bridges Farm found the teenagers lying in the dark. The girl had cuts and scrapes, but was not seriously injured. Then the labourer turned to the boy. Fred was lying motionless. He was out cold, and there was a fair amount of blood. When the ambulance arrived, the patient was judged to be in too serious a condition to be taken to any of the local cottage hospitals, so he was driven 14 miles to the city of Hereford, in the west of the county. In the early morning, Fred's battered helmet and Wellington boots were returned to Moorcourt Farm by a friend, who also delivered an alarming account of Fred's injuries, while an anguished Daisy sat mooning over her son's belongings. Walter walked up to Preston Cross to apologise to Pat Mann's family. Fred lay unconscious in Hereford Hospital. His vivid blue eyes were unfocused, rolled back in their sockets as if he were dead. Daisy held his hand and tearfully blamed herself for allowing him to buy the motorcycle. The wait stretched into days, and there were fears that he would never come round. A full week passed, and then, on the seventh day after the accident, Fred roused himself from the depths of unconsciousness. His befuddled mind slowly cleared, and he woke up. He later described the experience as like coming back from the dead. The relief felt by his mother was tempered by a sober appraisal of her son's injuries. Fred was a mess of lacerations and broken bones. He later claimed that a steel plate had to be fitted in his head to keep his shattered skull together. His nose was broken. Injuries to one arm would give him trouble for the rest of his life, and one leg was so severely smashed it had to be held together by a metal brace while the bone mended. Fred was given calipers and a metal shoe. For months after the accident, he stomped about Moor Court Cottage like Long John Silver, thumping the floor with his foot as he went. You could always tell when Freddy was coming back because he dropped one leg harder than the other. You could hear him coming at night, says his brother Doug. When, after several months, the leg iron came off, he still had a marked limp and had to use crutches to get around. The accident also altered what good looks he previously had. His nose was crooked, and one leg would forever be shorter than the other. The experience also left Fred with a lifelong dislike of hospitals. Despite these not inconsiderable handicaps, he drifted back into what social life he had enjoyed in Ledbury, hanging around the Market House building and the youth club. Bill Haley's Rock Around the Clock was one of Fred's favourite records, but his leg was so stiff that his movements looked comical when he tried to dance. He was angry with himself, and for the first time in his life became aggressive when other boys started making fun of him by saying that he wasn't any good. Fred was also finding life difficult at home. He told his friend June Ledbury that he was unhappy living at Moor Court Cottage, that he couldn't hack it anymore, and that his father was getting him down. It was at this time that Fred met one of the most significant women in his life. Catherine Bernadette Costello, known as Rena or Renee for short, was the girl who would become his first wife. She was a pretty 16-year-old with blue eyes, auburn hair, and a scar on her brow. They first met at a dance held at the Memorial Hall in Much Markle opposite the red brick village school where Fred had been educated. Rena was staying with relations in the area, having moved down from Scotland in the summer of 1960. Rena was from Cote Bridge, an industrial town a short drive from Glasgow in the district of Strathclyde. Her mother, Mary, left home when Rena was a young girl, and Rena's father, Edward, who worked in a scrap iron yard, had to bring up his five daughters and their two orphaned cousins on his own. The family, who had little money, lived in Calder Street, a long straight highway near the centre of the town. It is a grim area, dominated by a huge factory complex. Even the Church of Scotland near the Costello home is a monstrosity of dark stone, more depressing than inspiring. The local men drank hard in the evenings, and the streets glittered with broken glass after the pubs closed. Rena was a delinquent, in trouble with the police from a very early age. Her first appearance at Coatbridge Juvenile Court was for theft in May 1955, when she was only 11. Rena was admonished and sent home, but she was back again the following year, also charged with theft. Rena made her third court appearance in 1957, and this time was given a two-year probationary sentence. When she was caught stealing yet again, In March 1958, the magistrates committed her to an approved school, but this served only to harden her character and make her even more reckless. When she reached the age of 16, Rena left home and moved to Glasgow before travelling south to visit relations in England. Her life had already been something of an adventure in comparison to Fred's, who had only travelled as far afield as Barry Island. He tried to impress Rena with exaggerated stories, including the colourful account of his recent motorcycle accident. He said that he had actually died after the smash, but had come back to life when his body was laid on the cold marble of the mortician's slab. It was not Fred's fantasies which won Rena over. They came together because she was one of the few girls Fred had met who was prepared to accept his crude ways and, crucially, his demands for sex. Rena was so coarsened by life herself that she must have been grateful for any affection, even Fred's. She agreed to sleep with him. The relationship became so intense that Rena tattooed Fred's name on her left arm using a sewing needle and black Indian ink. Probably because of her association with Fred and the fact that she was staying out late at night, Rena had to leave her relation's house where she had been lodging. She moved into the New Inn public house in Ledbury High Street, sharing with a Scottish girlfriend. The girls were only there a matter of weeks and are remembered by landlady Eileen Phillips only because they stayed out late and damaged her furniture in the room by being careless with bottles of hair lacquer. By the autumn of 1960, Rena was struggling to find work and short of money. There had also been arguments with Fred, who was a jealous boy. She packed up and went home to Scotland. With Rena gone, Fred turned his attention to the younger girls he knew around Muchmarkle. It was at around this time that he began to pester a 13-year-old girl from the village. It was later claimed that he seduced the girl and continued to have sex with her secretly for the next 6 months, culminating in a scandal the following year. He also continued to visit the Ledbury Youth Club a couple of nights each week. The club was held in a dilapidated former domestic science building in a part of the high street known as the South End. The building was on two levels, and both the ground floor and first floor rooms were used on club nights. An iron fire escape led from the first floor down into the yard. One evening, in the autumn of 1960, Fred made a grab for a girl who was standing near him on the fire escape steps. But instead of giggling or running away, as his victims invariably did, she turned around and hit Fred. He lost his balance, toppled over the railing, and fell headfirst onto the concrete below. Teenagers rushed out of the club to look at Fred's stricken body. He lay perfectly still, and all efforts to revive him failed. He had fallen no more than 10 feet, but had banged his head and was out cold. His blue eyes dilated, blood wetting his curly hair. An ambulance was called and he was taken to the Cottage Hospital in Ledbury. He was still unconscious when he was examined by the doctor and was referred on to the main hospital in Hereford, where he had been a patient just over a year before. Once again, Daisy had to wait by her son's bed and pray for his recovery. Once again, his blue eyes lolled back in their sockets. This second period of unconsciousness, however, was not as long as the first, and he came round after 24 hours, but there were lasting effects. Fred became more short-tempered and irritable. His family began to wonder whether he had suffered brain damage. Now that Rena was gone and Fred had sold his motorcycle, he had little to do at the weekends in Ledbury. But Brian Hill was still a faithful companion, and one day the boys turned to petty theft for excitement. In the spring of 1961, they were sauntering through Tilly and Sons, a stationery store near the Lebury Clock Tower, when Fred saw a display of ladies' cigarette cases. He hissed to Brian, "Christ, these are nice," and on the spur of the moment put the cigarette cases into his pocket. The boys managed to make it outside without being caught, and flushed with success, Fred also snatched a gold watch strap from a display in Dudfield and Gainans, one of the town's jewellers. The boys slipped furtively along the high street and turned into a toilet by the Plough public house. Fred said it would be safer if they hid what they had stolen until they were ready to go home. Brian, who was a year younger than his friend, agreed to do whatever Fred thought was best, so they stashed the cigarette cases and watch strap on top of the cistern and then whiled away the hours until late afternoon. The shopkeepers had worked out that the thieves must be the two scruffy boys who had been loitering around the shops earlier in the day. They gave the police a description, and when Fred and Brian attempted to leave the town, they were stopped. Fred had the merchandise in his pockets. On a warm spring day in April 1961, Fred made his first ever court appearance, standing alongside Brian Hill in the dock of Lebury Magistrates Court. They were charged with stealing a rolled gold watch strap worth just over £2 and two cigarette cases. Brian and Fred pleaded guilty and were fined £4 each, plus costs. Outside the court, Fred put on a brave show, grumbling about the size of the fine, which was more than he earned in a week. Brian's mother was infuriated by the whole affair and by Fred's devil-may-care attitude in particular. She told Brian that he was to have no more to do with his friend, whom she believed had led her son into trouble. The case earned Fred his first newspaper report, three paragraphs on page one of the Lebury Reporter. The most significant event of Fred's youth came 2 months later, in June 1961. Moorcourt Cottage was thrown into turmoil when Fred was suddenly dragged before local police on a shockingly serious charge. He was bluntly told that he had been accused of having sex with a 13-year-old girl, the relationship which had allegedly started the previous December. A doctor had examined the child and discovered that she was pregnant. It was suggested that Fred had had sex with the girl four, or possibly five, times, and emphasised that she was a full 6 years younger than him. Far from being overwhelmed by the seriousness of the allegations, Fred was belligerent with the police, answering Detective Constable Bainham's questions as though they were completely unimportant. What was more scandalous to Daisy, when she found out, was that the family knew the 13-year-old well. Fred had been trusted in her company. "She was disgusted," says Daisy's sister-in-law, Edna Hill. Police, teachers, and social workers became involved in the affair that followed. When Fred was questioned about his attitude to sex, it emerged that he had been molesting young girls from his early teens, that he did not consider his actions to be unusual or shocking. In fact, he was sulky and petulant, put out that he had to talk about it at all. Of course it was right that he touched little girls, he argued, adding truculently, "Well, doesn't everyone do it?" The police charged him with having unlawful carnal knowledge of a child, and Fred was briefly kept in a cell while bail was arranged. It was his complacent attitude to the crimes that finally set him adrift from the normal world. After the accidents, the petty thieving, and the grabbing at girls, he had now made it absolutely clear that he was not fit to live with civilized people. Daisy agreed that the boy could not spend another night under her roof. It was a turning point in his life, a rejection that Fred would remember with great bitterness. He was sent to live with his mother's sister, Violet, and her husband Ernie at Daisy Cottage in Much Markle. None of the family back at Moorcourt Cottage would speak to him. The young girl had her child aborted, and Fred's case was set down for trial in November. Fred quit farm work, further distancing himself from his family. His decision was partly due to his father, from whom he wanted to get away more than ever, but he would have to leave the land anyway. Machinery was replacing farm workers, and the life that Walter had led was dying out. Many young men of Fred's generation found they had to move away from the village. For Fred, it would mean a lifetime of odd, manual jobs, but he always returned to the first trade he took up, building. He started as a labourer and then learned the rudiments of carpentry and bricklaying until he came to think of himself, rather grandly, as a fully fledged builder. John worked alongside him for a while and then went off on his own to become a lorry driver. Building sites afforded Fred ample opportunities to steal. He was working on a housing estate outside the town of Newent, Gloucestershire, when he was arrested for stealing pieces of hardware from the site. When Fred appeared at Newent Magistrates Court, he attempted to justify his actions by saying that other workmen took things, so why not he? Fred was fined £20. He was still getting himself in trouble with girls, and one former girlfriend, who cannot be named for legal reasons, claims she was raped twice by Fred at this time. He had wanted to marry the girl who lived in Newent and had even offered her an engagement ring, but she was only 14. 5 years younger than Fred, and Daisy West warned them not to have sex. She did not want the police coming to the house again. Despite this, the girl claims that Fred raped her on two occasions after she had turned 15, and that, curiously, he collapsed onto his back after the first assault as if he were experiencing some kind of attack. On the 9th of November 1961, shortly after his 20th birthday, the scruffy labourer with piercing blue eyes appeared in court to face the most serious criminal charges of his young life. He stepped into the dock at Herefordshire Assizes before Judge Justice Sachs to be tried for the alleged sexual abuse of the 13-year-old girl. Despite Daisy's disgust, Fred was still a member of the family and she agreed to be called as a defence witness. The other defence witness was the West family GP, Dr. Brian Hardy. It was during the questioning of Dr. Hardy by defence counsel that the possibility that Fred had suffered brain damage emerged for the first time. Dr. Hardy agreed with the defence that Fred had sustained head injuries through at least one motorcycle accident and might be epileptic as a result. A severe head injury is one of the most common causes of epileptic fits, and the longer the period of unconsciousness following an accident, the more likely it is that the victim will develop fits. Depending on the area of the brain scarred by the injury, there may also be personality changes. Brain damage was an explanation for Fred's behaviour that was seized upon by Daisy West. When it was her turn to speak, Daisy said that Fred took the blame for many misdemeanours which were not his fault. But her testimony proved unnecessary when, at the last minute, the child, who had made the allegations, refused to give evidence and the trial collapsed. Fred walked free from the court, but he was not welcome at home, and it is probable that this rejection marked his character. He thought he was the black sheep of the family, says his friend, Alf Macklin. At the age of 20, Fred was a convicted thief and widely believed to be a child molester. His moods were volatile and he may well have suffered brain damage. Shunned even by his own family, he had already become an outcast of society. Chapter 3. The Heller. The girl who became infamous as Rose West was born in Devon in 1953 when Fred was 12. To fully understand Rose and her relationship with Fred, it is necessary to reach back several years before her birth to examine the lives of her mother and father. They were both unusual, deeply troubled people whose marriage was violent and profoundly unhappy. Rose's father, William Andrew Letts, known as Bill, was born in 1921 and brought up in Northam, a small village near the town of Biddeford on the North Devon coast. His mother, Bertha Letts, worked as a nurse at the Battle of the Somme and became a district nurse in Northam when the Great War ended. Bill's father, also called Bill, was a shiftless, lazy man who dabbled in a variety of jobs. Northam was similar to Much Markle, 120 miles to the northeast, inasmuch as it is a quiet village cut off from the hurly-burly of the modern world. Northam is set upon a slight hill on a lip of land which juts into the confluences of the rivers Torridge and Tor, where their estuaries join the Bristol Channel. Laid out below the village is a rugged seaside park known as Northam Burrows, which ends in a sandy beach. The town of Biddeford is within walking distance south of the village. Barnstable is a few miles downriver to the east. The village was the scene of one great and violent historical event when, in the 9th century, a terrible battle was fought on the land where Northam now stands between the men of Alfred the Great and an invading army led by Hubba, King of the Danes. By the time the enemy had been driven back into the sea, the burrows were stained with the blood of 800 men. There are several small hotels around Northam, but it is not a picturesque seaside village. There is only a small tourist trade in the summer. The church and the buildings around the central square are constructed of gloomy stone. Bill Lett's family lived in a terrace house in Castle Street, one of the narrow roads that lead off the square. This part of Northam is as dark as a Rhondda Valley mining town. The marriage of Bertha and Bill Letts was not a happy one. Neither wanted children, and they were initially disappointed when, despite their best intentions, Bertha became pregnant. They changed their view when Bill Jr. was born and came to dote on what would be their only child. Bill was sickly, but his lack of strength only made Bertha love him all the more. She idolized her son and spent hours knitting warm clothes to keep illness at bay. Bill was struck down by rheumatic fever shortly before he was due to start at Northam's Church of England Secondary School. He was kept at home for many months, and when he finally enrolled, his classmates were astonished to see that he was wearing girls' woolen stockings under his shorts. The stockings, together with Bill having missed the start of school, made him the butt of classroom jokes. "We all thought it was very queer," says Ronnie Lloyd, who later became a friend. Bill was soon being bullied. When Bertha found out, she took it upon herself to go to the school and deal with his tormentors. He was also lonely at home. Bertha played cards in the evenings, leaving Bill with his father.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.